family and fled from that region to protect the family. You might want to write this down. God is more concerned about our obedience than he is our comfort. A lot of people say, God just wants me to be happy. God wants me to have all the best things in life. God wants me to have a house on the hill and everything else to go with it. But the reality is, God is more concerned about our obedience than he is our comfort. Does that make sense?
Yes.
God wants us to obey. How do we do that? Well, we do what God wants us to do with our lives. Notice the wise men in Matthew 2:11 under outline. It says, on coming to the house, they saw the child with his mother, and they bowed down and worshipped him. They worshipped this baby. And then they opened their treasures and presented him with gifts of gold and of incense and of myrrh. Now, why would they bring gold? Because they were coming to see a king. And kings were presented with gold. Now notice, they also brought incense, which were an object of worship. When they would be in the temple, they would light incense, and they would rise up to heaven, and it was kind of like they would have this beautiful smelling odor rising up to God. And we say, God, this is our sacrifice to you, these incense. Well, they brought that as a sign of worship to this king, this baby. They brought gold, they brought incense. There was one more thing that they brought, and that's myrrh. Now, some of you may not know what myrrh is. Well, myrrh is an embalming fluid in ancient times. Okay, and they would take dead bodies, and they'd wrap it in myrrh, they'd put it in myrrh, and they'd wrap it up, and it would preserve the body. Well, why would they bring myrrh to a baby? Think about it. They knew that this king, that this one that was God in human flesh, they knew he was going to die. And they brought that as an offering. Now let me just ask you, what do you bring to God each and every day? Think about that. You wake up, you brush your teeth, hopefully, right? Wash your face, take a shower, some of you, right? You get ready. And what do you present to God each and every day? Some people get up and totally ignore God all day long, and they say a prayer that's kind of like just some simple prayer that's, you don't really think about the words over your meal, or maybe you just forget about them and your Bible's under your seat all week long, and then you have to look for it to show up to church, right? What is it that you can offer to God on a daily basis? What could you offer him? Well, your day, God, this is your day. Help me to follow you throughout it. And I've got my plans, God, but your purpose will prevail in my life this morning, Lord. How about in my marriage? God, I promise you, Lord, that I'm going to do my best to watch my mouth with my spouse today. I give that to you today, Lord. Or my parents, God, help me not to be disrespectful to my mom or dad today. Or to your kids, God, help me to be an example of what a godly father or a godly mother is like, so that my kids will grow up and want to be like you, Lord. Now think about that. What is it that you have to offer God this morning? The wise men brought their gifts. Some of you have been holding your gifts back, your talents and your time. Notice the shepherds. The shepherds told everyone what had happened and what the angel had said to them about this child. They just went out and they were excited. Hey, did you hear about Jesus? Did you hear about the Messiah? He's born. We saw him. It was pretty cool. We were there. They went and told everyone. Well, what about you and me? Notice this. In his name, the nations will put their hope. Whose name? In Jesus' name. In his name, the nations will put their hope. God says this, you want to have hope? Give me your life. In his name, we'll have hope. Now, what are we hoping in today? A lot of stuff. I hope I get some good gifts Tuesday. Anybody else? All right. Yeah, I love Christmas, right? I hope that works out. But what are you hoping for today? What do you want God to do in your life? God wants to do something amazing in your life, but you've got to give him yours. If he's the hope of the world, doesn't it make sense that you would give him your life? If he really is the Savior that came to offer himself on a cross so you and I can go to heaven, why wouldn't you give him your life? Well, I want you to notice this. Romans 9:33, the last verse on your outline. Anyone who trusts in him, read the last part with me, will never be disappointed. Never be disappointed. God won't disappoint you. You know what? I'm going to disappoint you in 2008. You can count on it. Okay? The people that you love the most are going to disappoint you in 2008. There's going to be a lot of things that disappoint you in 2008. But you know what? God never disappoints. And the Bible says he never leaves us. He never forsakes us. We can always trust him. Now, that is good news this morning, guys. And if you have never given your life to Jesus Christ, I'm going to give you an opportunity to do that in a minute. But if you have been a Christian for a while, and you know that you've been holding stuff back from God, and you've been saying, God, I'm going to give this to you, this part of my life someday, and you haven't done it yet, I want you to challenge you to do it today. Okay? As we bow our heads and close our eyes, I want you to take some time to talk to God about what he's asking you to give him. Let's do that.